Hi there, Chris from Stone Age Gamer here, and welcome back to the gratuitous Rainbow Spectrum, and welcome to the PlayStation Report. Now, we've had a lot of fun with the Nintendo Report lately, and if you haven't seen what those videos are all about, basically we're looking back at every IP this company owns in alphabetical order and checking in to see how all of them are doing. And if there's another company out there besides Nintendo that you can do something like this to, it's PlayStation. Sony's got a ton of brands under their belt, so what we're gonna do is the same thing we've been doing with Nintendo. We're gonna go in alphabetical order and see how all their properties are doing. Today, we're gonna be talking about the letter A and all their stuff that goes with A and anything they have that may start with numbers, because why not throw numbers in there? And we're gonna see how their properties are doing. So how are PlayStation's A titles doing? Let's take a look. Alright, let's kick things off with numbers with Sony's Extreme series. Their Extreme games are a series of, well, extreme sports titles, which were rather popular back in the late 90s. Players took part in challenges involving everything from BMX bikes to inline skates to skateboards. This one's got a bit of an interesting history, too, because the first game in the series was called ESPN Extreme Games, but it was followed up by the immensely popular Too Extreme. The sequel didn't have any of the ESPN branding since Sony's contract with them had expired, so when they re-released the first game as part of their Greatest Hits line, they renamed it One Extreme and removed the ESPN stuff altogether. Neat. And also why this is filed under numbers instead of ESPN or X or E or whatever the heck. Anyway, its health rating is basically dead. 2 Extreme was followed up by 99 Studios' 3 Extreme in 1999. It took the series fully polygonal for the first time, which is a kind of wild thing to think back on here in 2024. Regardless, Sony promoted the heck out of it. However, the game's reception was far from good, and it never graduated to the PlayStation 2. In fact, the whole extreme sports games genre in general kind of disappeared, but honestly, I wouldn't be surprised to see a game like this perform reasonably well in the modern era. I would be genuinely shocked to see it happen, but I digress. It appears Sony has moved on. Now let's talk about Alundra. This one's actual ownership is kind of hard to nail down. Sony published both games in the series in Japan themselves, and the franchise has never appeared on any non-Sony platformers at all as far as I can tell, which suggests to me that they have at least some stake in the brand. However, other companies like Working Designs and even Activision published it in other parts of the world. But for the sake of this report, we're going to say it's technically a Sony franchise. And it's a pretty well-liked one at that. The original Alundra is an action-adventure game with a slick anime look and a focus on puzzle-solving that earned itself a decent following when it released. Members of its development team were even involved in the old Landstalker series that appeared on Sega's platforms. Its health rating is basically dead. Alundra hasn't been seen or heard from in a very long time. A direct sequel was released on PlayStation in 1999, but it was critically panned for having less than stellar controls and weirdly little to do with the original game that people loved so much. The first one was released on PSN back in the PS3 days as part of the PS1 Classics line, but that's about it. As far as I can tell, the game's developer, Matrix Software, is still in business, though they don't seem to have produced anything since 2020. I'm afraid Alundra might be gone forever. Next up, Ape Escape. Here we have one of Sony's most beloved IPs. Ape Escape was a huge hit on the PlayStation and has become a fan favorite brand ever since. It's a 3D platformer where you have to run around stopping apes with weird helmets from messing stuff up. It's a super fun series of games with bright, colorful visuals, endearing character designs, and even some catchy music. Its health rating, let's say, could be better. The last Ape Escape game was PlayStation Move Ape Escape, which was a motion-controlled rail shooter of sorts. Not exactly what fans of the series have been clamoring for, and that was way back in 2011. With that long of a gap since a new release, you'd think that it'd be basically dead, but Sony has absolutely not forgotten about this series. Ape Escape gets referenced a lot, which has successfully kept hope alive that a new, proper entry might still show up one of these days. The franchise is extremely malleable, too. The game before the rail shooter was 2009's Ape Quest, an Ape Escape RPG. Sony could do any number of things with this great brand. Sadly, they seem to have chosen nothing instead. Now let's talk about Ark the Lad. This is another series where Sony's ownership is, let's just say, in question. The series has only ever appeared on PlayStation consoles, the WonderSwan, and mobile devices. And yes, Sony themselves have published a number of the releases, including the mobile iterations, so we're going to include it here, just with the usual asterisk of, well, who really knows. It's a tactical RPG series that started life on the PlayStation in 1995, but only in Japan. Its health rating is okay. Ark the Lad has seen numerous sequels and spin-offs, the latest of which was 2018's Ark the Lad R. Like I said above, that was published by Sony for mobile devices, but was never localized outside of Japan. The service shut down in 2021, which really wasn't all that long ago. It's hard to say where the series really stands within Sony these days, but the mobile game's servers lasting for 3 years is a respectable run. I bet we'll see Ark the Lad again, but whether or not we get a proper console release, or another mobile game, remains to be seen. And now, Astro Bot, one of PlayStation's newest stars, sort of. Astro Bot exploded in popularity earlier this year with the frankly awesome Astro Bot for PlayStation 5, but this little fella's history can be traced all the way back to 2016's The Playroom VR for PS4, though if you wanted to get technical, there's also an early version of the character in 2013's The Playroom, but no matter where you consider his origins, there's no denying he didn't really take off until this year, and it's about darn time, too. Astro's pretty freaking adorable. His health rating is great. If you had asked me a few months ago, I would have said the likelihood of seeing a new Astro game was slim to none. Astro's Playroom was super cool, but it didn't really smell to me like something Sony would turn into an actual franchise. Boy, am I glad I was wrong! Astro Bot turned out great, and I am far from the only one who feels that way. It's colorful, fun, and chock full of all sorts of PlayStation references from the company's history. I suspect we'll be seeing plenty of this little guy in the future. And last but not least, we have ATV Offroad Fury. This was one of those games on the PS2 that was absolutely everywhere. It was easily one of the most common games to find in any pre-owned shop, and just about everyone with a PS2 owned it or at least played it at some point in their lives. It easily moved enough copies to make it into Sony's greatest hits line and was generally a well-liked game. It's obviously an ATV racing game, it's got solid graphics, solid controls, solid stuff all around, and its health rating is basically dead. Talk about a series that burned bright only to disappear into the ether. There was a whopping 4 entries released on the PlayStation 2, with the latter two also being ported to PSP. The series changed developers halfway through, and then it actually crossed over with Acclaim and THQ's MX games, but the mainline series itself stopped with ATV Offroad Fury 4 in 2006. It seems to have been relatively well-liked, too, so its disappearance from Sony's slate is sort of mystifying. It's not like ATVs stopped being cool. We're now more than 2 console generations removed from this series without so much as a digital re-release on PSN as far as I can tell. I think Sony's given up on this series for good.
Well, there you have it, folks. That is the first entry in the PlayStation Report, and it was a pretty dour one, to be sure. But PlayStation, they approach their properties a lot different than Nintendo does. They don't put a lot of stock in keeping a lot of old brands alive so much as they, at least up until the last couple of years, they've really put a focus on just, well, let's just create something new, new properties over and over again. And they've done a wonderful job with that. That said, there really is something to be said for older brands staying alive. Like, how has it been so long since there's been a new Ape Escape game? There are a handful of games in this list that are genuinely surprising we haven't seen in a while. But we'll see how this goes in the future, because this is just the letter A. We've got a long road ahead of us, and well, I guess we'll see next time what the letter B has in store. So thank you much for watching, everybody. If you like what you saw here today, please follow, comment, like, subscribe, share, and let us know which PlayStation properties that start with the letter A would you like to see return into the foreground. Thanks again. On behalf of all of us here at Stone Age Gamer, keep playing games.